This is my honor and pleasure to greet Professor Rosie Braidotti, who is a professor of gender studies at the University of Utrecht. You have got an Italian name, you were brought up in Australia, and now you are a distinguished professor of the University of Utrecht. How did you end up being a professor in Holland?
Well, I'm very much a nomadic individual, but it comes from my history as a migrant. I am a typical European in some ways. I'm moving between cultures and languages, and I think there are millions of Europeans that have sort of family histories similar to mine. We don't talk very much about this phenomenon of how widespread migration is among what could be considered mainstream Europeans. My family is not, to my knowledge, Jewish. It's not particularly been sort of the object of sort of religious or other forms of discrimination. And the movements that we have had from Italy to Australia, from Australia in my case, back to France, and from France back to the Netherlands, where I got my chair at a very young age, are determined by a mixture of economic necessities, and in my case, an intellectual itinerary that then developed from it. But studying, I think, what people call the white migration, it's a misnomer, but it's one way of addressing it, brings into focus the extent to which a great deal of Europeans are really subjects of in-between cultures. And this status as migrants, which I define in terms of the nomadic conditions, I think needs to be thought a lot about it.
What was in your intellectual luggage when you left Italy?
I left Italy at the age of 15. I was quite young, I hadn't finished high school, and I was already very much involved in reading philosophy and reading the great texts. I don't know why philosophy as an archive always appealed to me. And I was reading bits of Plato, and I remember reading Baudelaire even on the boat that took us to Melbourne, Australia. It was a very long trip.
When you arrived to Australia, what was the most amazing for you?
Being an Italian immigrant in Melbourne in 1970 wasn't particularly fashionable. It wasn't trendy at all, it wasn't glamorous. Multiculturalism became a reality in Australia much later. And millions of Italians and Greeks and Eastern Europeans, of course, migrated to Australia. But in those days, in the late 60s, early 70s, we were still very much under the burden of a certain type of discrimination as being non-WASP, non-Anglos. So the first impact was not terribly positive. I don't think I enjoyed being a migrant, and it was a lesson that was very helpful for me for years later when I started thinking about migrant conditions, hybrid identities, mixity. My own experience of that spoke very loudly through my head and through my heart, because it is really a very uncomfortable condition. There was a certain amount of pain and certainly uprootedness involved, but also an amazing sense of discovery, an amazing sense of possibilities. And Australia was immensely generous in providing education and facilities and opportunities that I feel enormous gratitude for. I remember getting a scholarship almost immediately to see me through the last year of high school. And I then finished high school with very high results in the final examinations, and I was given a wonderful scholarship called the National Undergraduate Scholarship that took me to the National University in Canberra, where for 5 blissful years I received really a world-class education with all the benefits and all the incredible advantages of that. So, and my teacher in Canberra was a famous feminist philosopher, what was to become a famous feminist philosopher by the name of Jenny Lloyd, who was still unknown at the time.
What was the impact of your first 5 years in this institution on your belief that you want to do something different with pedagogy than you previously done?
I think that the entire section of my life that was Australian, also because of the age, 15 to 24, has had a lasting influence in everything I've shaped as my career, both at high school and at university, but at high school particularly, so 70 to 72, 73, I had very dedicated teachers. You have to imagine a high school where we had something like 17 different nationalities, kids coming off the boats, off the migrant sort of assembly camps, as they still have them. I often, when I go back to Melbourne, go back to the camp where we were put. There were very high-class camps with normal apartments, but there were sort of camps where the migrants were coming. So you would be coming off those camps, off those boats, in this high school that had a failure rate at a national examination of something like 90%. And nobody from that school really made it into university. And the years that I was there, which was the end of the White Australia policy and the end of decades of centre-right-wing government, the Labour Party was putting on a huge political campaign to change the government. It was called It's Time for a Change. And the leader that they were campaigning for is, again, a famous historical figure, was Gough Whitlam, the man that would eventually become Prime Minister and give Australia some of the best and most progressive policies ever. The Labour Party selected our high school as an example, as a guinea pig, to prove that migrants with proper education could actually made it and make it into higher education. So we were pre-selected as the training sort of field, in return for which we campaigned actively for the Labour Party. And I was very, very active in the student and teachers committees to do cultural action for freedom, Paulo Freire type of pedagogy. We put on school theatre. I remember doing a Pirandello play and being the producer of the play, showing to Australians what a wonderful culture Italy had, because in 1970 Australia still thought of Italians as these desperados coming off the boat, speaking a funny language and selling pizzas. Little did they know that we had a glorious culture, and our Greek friends were doing the same thing, the Lebanese were doing the same thing. So cultural action for freedom, that had a lasting influence upon me. We got, Gough Whitlam won the federal election, Labour Party went into power, which hadn't happened for decades, and our school got a sizable subsidy. We're talking about $500,000 then, for which we rebuilt the entire school, built a new library, and I got myself the scholarship that got me to Canberra. In the school today, there is still a little plaque that thanks the generation of 72, 73, because we actually rebuilt the school. Now, capitalism being what it is, 10 years later, so by the 80s, the demographic and sociological configuration of the inner city of Melbourne changed. The migrants were moving out to the outer suburbs because they wanted better and bigger houses. And the yuppies, you know, were moving back in because they wanted smaller houses in closer to the center of the city. So by the end of the 80s, this wonderful school that we had campaigned for the migrants, sociologically became the school for the children of the yuppies, and eventually in the 90s became an institute of technology. So if you look at the history of the school, it reflects in some sense the configuration of the inner cities. And I regret that today the children of the migrants are not profiting from the school that is really very beautifully done. That, I think, was a lasting influence in what it means to be a teacher when you're working with disadvantaged children and students.
When you decided to leave for France, why did you decide to do so?
Again, the influence of teachers. The 5 years that I studied in at Australian National University were, again, the lasting influence in my life. Jenny Lloyd was my thesis supervisor, my BA honours. We had an honour system then. A remarkable woman, an incredible teacher. She was then still called Jenny Small, and she hadn't written The Man of Reason, which is the book that would then, in a sense, be the starting text of a certain type of feminist philosophy. But she was my teacher, and in the course on the history of philosophy, she used the text of Michel Foucault as a commentator on the history of philosophy. So we were reading Foucault as secondary literature. And I didn't even know where he was teaching until one day my uncle, who is a Catholic priest working as a missionary in Switzerland with Italian migrants, sent me a clipping from Il Corriere della Sera with an article by Foucault saying, this is a man that you should be interested in. So I discovered that he was actually alive and well teaching in Paris. And that was it. And almost overnight, I knew that I had to go and study philosophy with this man. So I finished my BA thesis, handed it in, did not even wait for the results. I already had a scholarship from the French government, and off I went. I remember landing in October and going directly to the Collège de France to sit in the front row and listened to what I thought was the most spectacular philosophical mind I had ever sort of listened to. It is equally true that I knew that I wanted to come back to Europe. I knew that I couldn't stay in Australia for a number of reasons that have to do with my awareness of being a European. It didn't particularly work for me, which caused a sort of a moral dilemma because I owe Australia almost everything. And I think I've paid back by acknowledging it and by teaching there and by keeping a lot of connections to it. But I regret that I couldn't, for a number of reasons, make my life there. From the moment I landed in Paris, that I'm home.
Fabulous and well-known philosopher. So if you can just list your genealogy as far as the famous philosophers are concerned.
It was a good choice of time. 77, 78, everybody that is now the historical fathers and mothers of post-structuralism was teaching. And at the Collège de France, you had the choice of Roland Barthes or Michel Foucault, and you had to queue up for hours to get into those places. Later on, Bourdieu would join that, but Vernon was still teaching. Lévi-Strauss wasn't too far off. I don't think he was already not teaching, but he was around. But at Vincennes, the glorious University of Vincennes, you had Lyotard, you had Deleuze and Guattari, you had and still have Hélène Cixous. At Jussieu, there was Kristeva, still is there, and Marcel Marigny, the group of women historians led by Michel Perrault. But more important, so it was completely, Sartre was still around, Simone de Beauvoir was absolutely around. But more importantly, the political climate was so alive, was so incandescent, that you got to meet everybody. There was ample opportunity to meet these people in cafes, in demonstrations, in meetings, in intellectual sort of events. It was a very dynamic social atmosphere. For people who know France today, it's unimaginable. It was as if the social codes had been scrambled, and because of the political engagements, you got to meet everybody. I met Delphine Seyrig, Marguerite Duras, you met them because they were next to you in a meeting about the beginning of the Iranian Revolution or the latest abortion campaign. That's how I met Lucie Riqueret, who had just been kicked out of everything by Jacques Lacan, who didn't enjoy her book Speculum, so she was practically unemployed, surviving as an analyst, but she was around. We organized several demonstrations together. She was manning, as we say, the phone, answering the phone. Organizing the big demonstration in, I think it was 79. So it was a moment where it was easy to circulate. And then as the right-wing repression came in, Paris gradually shut down. And today it's like one of the films of Agnès Varda, where it all have these closed doors and brutally unfriendly walls, and it's very difficult for foreigners. Then it wasn't. It was a very fluid situation. So I got an amazing 3 years until Mitterrand won the election in 81, and then already the situation changes. But those 3 years were just fantastic in the kind of degree of rigor and radicalism. It was that combination that made the post-structuralist generation absolutely extraordinary in the way they combined the love for knowledge with an equally strong commitment to change, to transformation, to being active in the social sphere. That was really mind-blowing.
You spent these very exciting 3 years in Paris, so how did it influence your work, and who are those figures who are exceptionally influential in your own biography?
I think Paris made me, and it is the other moment. I think Australia supported me. Paris made me in the sense of being exposed to the great theories of subjectivity, of agency, of ethics, of the second half of the 20th century. It was that combination between doing theory and doing politics, being active in the public sphere and being really thorough and rigorous as a scholar, that was unique. Because I had really had received an education in the Commonwealth, in the English system, where being a good scholar was enough. I mean, British academia, and Australia would be an example of it, doesn't sort of value political engagement as something that matters. I mean, you're supposed to, get on with the business of being a rigorous scholar. And Paris spoke more to my Italian heart in building a notion of excellence that involved caring for the social, being involved in the social. It began really, the first earthquake was being able to meet Simone de Beauvoir, because she was very active, she was a militant in a number of feminist collectives to which I was also kind of participating as a student, as a graduate student sitting in the background taking notes as Beauvoir debated the latest issues with the members of the collective. The collective was Le Sexisme Ordinaire, which was the feminist branch of Le Temps Moderne, the great journal that they did together. And just, you know, I don't know, being in 26, 27, meeting Simone de Beauvoir, I'll never forget that day. You just think, I'm touching history. This is like, you know, you can't speak a word, your tongue is parched, you're breaking into a sweat, you look like an idiot, and but you are meeting history. And she was very kind, very lovely, very supportive. But I mean, she was Simone de Beauvoir, and what was this? So there was a sense of being in the flow of history, I think, in it being where things were happening. And I think when you are at that age and in my level of intensity and curiosity, that really mattered. The other crucial meeting was meeting Lucy Rigaray as an individual. It was what I call now in my work the first Rigaray, the Rigaray that runs until 1984. She had just written Speculum, The Sex, which came out the year I arrived. And until 84, she writes this really, in my opinion, groundbreaking analysis of how the feminine works in the history of philosophy. After 84, it takes a different form, and she also undergoes personal transformations that make her more difficult. But in this early phase, she was perfectly friendly and very open. And I admired how she used psychoanalysis in order to produce political analysis. That is, again, a skill that is not very, very widespread in the Anglo world. The Anglo-Saxon world is not literate, is not fluent in issues of psychoanalytic theory. They consider psychoanalysis a funky and strange, or a therapy, a clinical discourse. And I never worked with Lacan, although he was teaching in my days. I went to a lecture, but I mean, you couldn't enter the Lacanian thing easily. So I got my Lacan through working with Lucy Rigaray, who could analyze social event in terms of patterns of desire, patterns of fantasy, and that I thought were absolutely fascinating. At the level of teachers, Foucault was mesmerizing. And with Foucault at the Collège de France, you knew, again, that this was history, and that this was going to change the shape of things, not only because you had to queue for hours to get in. There were, you know, one room with him and three rooms with videos and audio. So it already, at a very young age, he was recognized as a maître penseur, as a master, but also because, of course, he himself made it clear that you would have to acknowledge his status. He was very status conscious, and he kind of pursued a certain type of greatness deliberately. So that was one clear master. I almost by mistake ended up going to the seminars of Gilles Deleuze. I knew the name, but I hadn't really studied him. He was not part of my curriculum. And even just physically going to Vincennes from the central town where we had our dorms was an enterprise, because Vincennes was in the middle of the Bois de Vincennes. It's an hour away, and because it was the radical university, it had very poor facilities, and everything was, you know, you had to go through police pickets sometimes, the picket lines, to even enter a university, which Giscard d'Estaing eventually shut down completely and removed to Saint-Denis, where it is even today. So even physically, going to Foucault at the Collège de France or going to Gilles Deleuze at the Bois de Vincennes was a completely different geopolitical excursion. And I remember going to Deleuze's classes, sitting down, it was a tiny room, everybody was smoking, it was incredibly uncomfortable, and he started talking, and I swear to God, I did not understand one word, but I knew that this was sheer genius. With Foucault, you knew this was a master, and he was going to redesign the shape of things to come. This, with Deleuze, this was a man from the future saying stuff that you thought, is this. So it took me the first 3 months to be able to have the first Deleuzian concept sinking into me, and then it took me years to actually be able to come to terms with him. And this is why in my dissertation I don't do a lot with Deleuze, I do a little in Patterns of Dissonance, which is the book from my dissertation. I have a chapter on him, but it is minimal. I think I waited years to be able to say something sensible about a thinker that, in my opinion, is shaping the third millennium much more than Foucault ever could. There's a philosophical discussion, but Foucault, in a moment of generosity, said, un jour le siècle sera Deleuzien. One day, the century will be Deleuzian. It's one of the few generous statements that Foucault ever made, and he was right. So these are the two thinkers, and you may notice they're both male philosophers, and neither of them particularly feminist.
So how did feminist philosophers come into the picture?
It has become a trend of feminist philosophers that they don't have jobs in philosophy. So, as I said, working with Irigaray absolutely helped. Jenny Lloyd was still my supervisor from afar. She came to Paris several times and we had discussions. But when I went to school, I graduated from the Sorbonne in 81, there were simply no feminist philosophers in any positions. In my dissertation, I provide an overview of the texts that we had then in feminist philosophy. There are exactly four or five. And I recently wrote another overview essay where, as I was saying, there's just no comparison, but what we have in terms of feminist philosophy today, there's encyclopedias, glossaries, there's everything. It's like unaccountable for it, so enormous. In 81, there was nothing. So the level of loneliness was extremely high, but who cared? Because it was at a time before the entry into the institutions where the essence of the debates were political outside the universities. So you ended up working with people who would then become famous philosophers. The years I went through Paris, there were two other things happening. One was the exodus of the Italian terrorists who were fleeing Italian state repression. I mean, Toni Negri was around as a refugee. He was wanted by every major international agency. It was protected essentially by Mitterrand, but even prior to Mitterrand by the French state tradition of hospitality. And he was teaching Spinoza seminars, he was working with Deleuze. So there was an Italian influx. I remember meeting Emma Bonino when she was out in Paris visiting the other Italians, being completely radical. Okay, not a philosopher, but a great figure. So that was one thing that was happening. And for an Italian living in Paris, seeing Italian refugees coming to Paris discussing the armed revolution was certainly an experience that I found both alienating and exhilarating. The other thing that was happening was the Americans, and what I have called later on the transatlantic disconnections. And the Americans were coming to Paris because of the great masters. And I went through school with Alice Jardine, Jane Gallup, for a while Jane Weinstock, a filmmaker. From Australia, we had Anna Gibbs, Mia Campioni, Megan Morris was there, Paul Patton arrived the year I went there. So there was a whole Anglo-American and sort of English-speaking community of people, some of whom will produce feminist philosophy. If you look at the first translations of Foucault and Irigaray into English, they are made by Australians, essentially Megan Morris and Paul Patton. They related translations back to Sydney, where a very young Elizabeth Gross and a very young Moira Gatens were going through graduate school. So you get this incredible connection, Paris-Sydney, which will be one of the great axes for the production of feminist philosophy, because I don't have to tell you who Liz Gross and Moira Gatens were going to become, or who Jane Gallup was going to become. At the time, of course, you didn't know. This was who you went to school with. But there was a dissemination of information happening, which I think will produce a great generation of radical philosophers and feminist philosophers. But at that particular point in time, looking around, there was just nobody. It was before Martha Nussbaum got her chair, before Iris Young got her chairs. It was just a moment before it was really about to get consolidated. So it was both exciting and somewhat lonely.
So where did you go with a PhD from Sorbonne in an environment when there were no women philosophers?
Well, I had a very wonderful supervisor, Hélène Vedrine, who just did all the administration for me and kept me going. I discussed my chapters with the peer group. We set up together with Alice and Jane and a lot of other people, a study group, a sort of a PhD seminar, and we supervised each other. And if you look at Alice Jardine's big book, Gynesis, and my book, Patterns of Dissonance, we have a footnote in which we acknowledge the role that we played in each other's life, because we actually read each other's work and commented in some work and way the work is very similar. There was, however, a very major difference. Whereas my American or English-speaking friends returned to their respective countries, the Americans went back to the States, Australians mostly went back, I decided not to. And I think that the decision to stay in Europe, or what I call my becoming European again, had an enormous influence on the way my work and my career shaped. For one thing, having finished a dissertation in record time, or within the required time, I then went back home to Melbourne for a few months. Then I thought, no, I can't stay here. I went back to Paris, and there I was, unemployed, with an Australian passport and with no career prospects. So deciding to stay in that place and continue to do philosophy like that set me back years. If you look at my first book, Patterns of Dissonance, it comes out in 1991. I wrote it 10 years earlier. And in between, all of my American friends get their publications out much faster, because the American publication system is simply much faster. So the choice to stay on there for a while became a moment of great confusion. In that moment of confusion, when I decided not to go back to Australia, being in Paris without knowing exactly what to do with myself, I went into analysis. I did 7 years of really good psychoanalysis, which is not therapy, it's psychoanalysis, while I was teaching philosophy for Columbia University campus in Paris, working for UNESCO as a research assistant. I had good jobs, but itsy-bitsy things, I can't complain. They were exciting, but they were not, let's say, a traditional academic career. I thought at that point in time that I would never have a traditional academic career, that in fact, by deciding to stay in Europe, I had given up the career, because France wasn't offering jobs. The stuff that I was doing was new, weird, and there was no commitment to feminist philosophy. So I thought, okay, my coming back means that I will teach English for a living, or God knows, I don't care. I was young and sort of flamboyant. And by my analysis, it was a lot about investigating the modes of belonging. You know, where should I go? You know, what should I do with myself? And not that I had any, you know, great drama, but there was a certain amount of confusion about where to go as a migrant, turned nomad, etc. And I worked through it in the years that I was preparing the manuscript for the book, started publishing, started going to conferences. I was invited by a number of people, including Mieke Baal, to a conference in the Netherlands, which went very well. There was the famous conference where Adrian Rich delivered the paper on the politics of location in the big church in Utrecht. I remember that, another defining moment, because my paper went very well. And when a few years later the Dutch were advertising the chair in women's studies, they asked me to apply. So at the age of 33, I applied and eventually got the first chair in women's studies at the University of Utrecht. And I took the unimaginable step of leaving France, which had been the reason why I had left Australia, and go to a country that I had never imagined that I would end up in, which has proved the cradle of my happiness and well-being, which is the Netherlands. I should say also that by then, and we're looking at 88 then, a lot had happened to France. Mitterrand election in 1981 brought the left into power. Retrospectively, that was the death of the radical left. It was an immense normalization process that brought people like Bernard Kouchner to power then, as he is in power now, with a very different administration. And for a foreigner, a very bitter moment, because as my French friends, Geneviève Fraisse would be an example, sailed through an amazing career, the foreigners one by one dropped out. There were some exceptions. My good friend Nancy Houston built a really good career as a fictional writer. But again, it wasn't an academic career. We also went through graduate school together, and I love Nancy's work, but she stayed in a sense outside. So I became convinced that the profound ethnocentrism of the French wouldn't make it possible for me to build a career, and I started looking elsewhere. The other thing that happens is the deaths. One by one, all the greats go. I mean, it begins with the suicide of Poulantzas, then it goes on with the Althusser murdering his wife, and then Sartre dies, then Simone de Beauvoir dies, then Barthes is hit by a bus, and then Foucault goes. You know, it's just like you think, well, what's the world coming to? There was a sense of an end of an era, very dramatic. It was, the intellectual Paris was in a state of shock. People were either at the Élysée Palace or attending another funeral. So I really got a sense of a tremendous crisis. This is the moment where Lucie Rigoret has her personal crisis, goes into a deep depression and emerges from it transformed. Rigoret is somebody today that I don't particularly like as a person. I really love her work still, although the second Rigoret is not nearly as interesting as the first one. So I thought, in a sense, it was over, and I went to this other place that I never thought, as I said, that I could be happy. It's the Netherlands.
What did the Netherlands bring you, intellectually, politically, and as a teacher?
The Netherlands is the most amazing phase of my life, also because it's still ongoing. I can't imagine, it's been 20 years that I've lived there. A constant surprise because of the type of complexity and contradictions that the Dutch have. It's an amazing, surprising bundle of contradictions. But for me, a place where, as a white immigrant, I was really welcomed with open arms. A place of enormous realism. I was given a chair at the age of 33 with a sizable budget and a very simple mandate. Build a gender studies program, a women's studies program. Do what you want, just build it. You have 3 years. If you don't have results in 3 years, we start cutting backs. And I had a three-year contract, or 3 to 5 year contract. I didn't have tenure for years in Melbourne. It was like on a trial basis. I mean, you know, not. I had a very clear idea in my head of what I wanted to do. I hired women of my age, which didn't please the old guard, which had been around the university for years. And so we started up generationally, packing all the real sort of a second waivers and sending them home, because universities in the 70s in the Netherlands had hired anybody that walked in, and we insisted on people with a PhD or people doing a PhD standards, you know, introducing standard and selection, younger generation, and we built gradually what I think is today a fantastic program. So it gave me a grounding and a challenge that really, in a sense, matched both my ambition and the visions that I had inherited in or developed in Paris. And to be given a chance to implement your ideas at 33, when you are a high-flying speculative philosopher, is unbelievable. Only the Dutch, because they build into it their profound social realism. You fail, you're gone. The year I came to the Netherlands, they gave something away like 15 or 17 chairs throughout the country. It was a national plan coming from The Hague, because the bureaucracy had absorbed the lessons of the 60s and 70s, a national plan to construct gender studies. And Utrecht got 2 chairs, and Amsterdam got an infinite number of chairs, and every university in the country got a number of chairs. 20 years later, I think 3 of those chairs are still standing. The others have been phased out. So there is a sense of social Darwinism, if we wish, careful planning, very generous, but you deliver. If you don't deliver, you're dead. And I find that extremely reassuring. So it is generous, but it is also careful with its management. So I discovered, which I didn't know, that I'm actually a very good manager, that I can construct structures, that I can put my radical pedagogy to the service of constructing institutions, and then my very famous diplomatic skills to the service of networking. So then Utrecht gave me a platform to do European work, which I was very passionate and remain very passionate about, because Holland wants to be a European platform. It gave me a job that pays extremely well. It gave me my partner, whom I adore and I'm legally married to. And 2 years ago, it even gave me a knighthood. So I am a vehement Dutch patriot, and I am immensely grateful to this unexpected location of mine.
You are married to a woman in the Netherlands. What is the significance of this fact for your life?
Most extraordinary. It was part of the great surprises that were awaiting for me as I moved to the Netherlands. I hadn't really been into women in my previous emotional and sex life. Paris, there were sort of some little flings, but it wasn't anything serious. Man had been at the center of my life, really, in different ways, not always happy ones. Although questions about identity and sexual identity were much part of both the feminist process and of life in Paris. And then when I went to the Netherlands, I met Annika, and that was it. It was one of those situations, and it's all very, very banal, and we've both written about it. And she remembers seeing this light around me, and I remember equal sort of flashes. It really was a very, very strong encounter, a very passionate, very complicated, because she was also living with a man. So it was a very difficult, passionate beginning in the grand tradition of the great passions. So sometimes you meet an individual and a bomb goes off and you think, God, what is that? And from there, after, you know, the turmoil of the passion, because passions are difficult things, it involved her leaving her then partner and hurting him, obviously. And it involved her trying to work out, juggling a big job challenge with a huge passion. And after 2-3 years, we finally, of living this and fighting it out, we've settled into what then has become a very loving and caring relationship. It didn't start off as loving and caring. It started off as passion and intensity. And we're now into our 20th anniversary. And in 1999, we decided to marry because, again, a marriage hadn't been part of my plans. But we thought not only was gay marriage finally, it was the first phase of gay marriage in the Netherlands, but also it was the end of the millennium. So I said to Annika, I will marry if we can marry on the 8th of March, which is International Women's Day, in the last year of the century, the last century of the previous millennium, and the century which will go down in history as the century of women. So the 8th of March, 1999, we found a slot in the city hall, and we got married with all of Annika's family, my sister, my best friend attending. And I guess it was both a recognition of the relationship, which is the center of my life, and also a way of institutionalizing our relationship. I think that Annika and I, in our public role, are certainly very solid members of the international gay bourgeoisie. We are a solid salt of the earth couple. She's a university professor also in visual culture. So these two women in love, two professors, one has been knighted. I think if you're a young lesbian or bisexual student anywhere, you would look up to us thinking, oh my God, I want to be like that. So we're taking that role very seriously by being a very ethical couple as well in our behavior. I think we are model citizens, really. And anybody who's scared of gay marriage or of lesbians who marry should just come to dinner with us and see how we behave and how we live and be utterly reassured that we are the essence of European civilization and great citizens. So it was also a recognition of what we had become in the eyes of others, because these public rituals like marriage essentially happen in the eyes of others. And I think we are very pleased and very kind of proud of what we'll be able to achieve in this relationship, which is the other big achievement of my life. And it's a big project in my life.
You built up the best women's studies center in Utrecht. So then you decided to leave, partly. Now you are a distinguished professor and the director of the humanities. So what did this women's studies center give you? As a possibility to implement your radical ideas, radical politics, plus this very strong morality at the same time with this academic rigor, what you are actually famous for.
Thank you very much. I think you said it all. It was a great opportunity to do activism in and through theory, and it to be able to build something from scratch in an area as volatile politically as feminism and gender was an incredible opportunity. It fitted in with a pattern in my life from high school through to the Paris days, to try to have an activist reading of what you do, to keep the radicalism of the pedagogy, get very, very involved in with the student that you're working with, shape their lives, take accountability for the impact of the ideas and the notion that you throw around, be present, be there, and see it as an ongoing process. All of this was possible within the context of a new curriculum, a new course of study, both in virtue of my own sort of standards and in honor of the Dutch tradition, we really kept up academic grades and academic standards. It was of the greatest importance. The key to success was to convince the opposition that this was feasible. So this combination of rigor and radicalism, which I had learned from my teachers in Paris, really became implemented, and that is an incredible opportunity that one is given. I learned and I continue learning tremendously from it. Being able to hire all of the staff, being able to select one by one all the colleagues, I have amazing colleagues, but I mean, let's face it, I hired them all, so I made sure that I hired people that I could work with, and then I think we've grown into a very, very strong team, and we have now generations of students, because 20 years is a long time in academia. It's like 4 or 5 generations of graduates that are working in the world, that are circulating and continuing, in a sense, the tradition. I decided to move out after 20 years out of a question of democracy, essentially, and out of also a respect for my own sense of development. 20 years is a very long time, and at the same time it went in a flash, because it was very busy. There was a lot to do, to construct the BA, to construct the MA, to construct the research master, to build the PhD programs. I have supervised 25 dissertations to date, in between everything else. So it was very intense, and at one particular point I thought, well, I can't go on like this all my life. And what's more, the project, the program itself, can't be constantly under my unquestionably charismatic personality. It's not fair. And to be the founding professor puts you in a position where after 10 years, you know, you are the uncontested leader. After 15, you are an icon. After 20, you know, you are an emperor. I mean, it was really becoming too much. People were jokingly referring to me as the Tsarina of women's studies, particularly also because I founded all the European networks. So I founded NOIS, and I founded Athena. Athena is, as you know perfectly well, a huge organization. These things need a democratic turnover, and I needed to be free from this project. Utrecht is, in some ways, my best book. If people ever look back at what I've done, I hope they consider the whole Utrecht experiment as the book of my life. To do that, to keep that together, took resources that I don't even know I had, took the best of me, continues to take, because I'm still there. And the theoretical books should be really read against what the program is, what it does, how it functions, what I think it, how it has affected the lives of, you know, generations of students. So I wanted to convince myself, the institutions, and new generations that it was strong enough to stand without me. This was not an easy operation. The University of Utrecht was not happy with this. They were convinced that the moment I pulled to the side, the whole thing would come crashing down. And I knew that this was not the case. So we went back and forth. It lasted almost 3 years. I had to threaten to take a job in London to force the university to finally say, okay, we appoint a new director. I stay there as a teacher, but I do a different have a different job definition in the faculty. And lo and behold, the program, you know, holds perfectly well, and the new generation is in place doing marvelous work. And I'm now teaching the courses that I designed. I am now just teaching them as a guest teacher, and the main teacher is a 28-year-old who does the history of feminist theory like a 28-year-old of today, trained by us, can do the history of feminist theory brilliantly. And I am resource material. I am sort of part of the history. I'm also, you know, the founding mother of it all, but I am slightly on the side of it. I find it, for me, immensely liberating. It makes me free to think about other issues and to step back and finally look at this thing, and lo and behold, it's a gorgeous program. And I never had the time to stand on the side and look at it and say, my God, that is amazing. Because when you're in the middle of it, you can't do it. And I have the same with the Athena network. I stand on this and I think, my God, that all of that could actually function. So it's enormously relieving, and it opens my mind to a number of other things that I want to do. It wasn't simple. There are moments of sadness. There are moments where I miss it terribly, but I am there. But I think it's very healthy in terms of feminist ethics to let it go. Like, I think a good mother has to let the child go. I made you. I would love to hold you in my hands forever. I'm letting you go. And I think that for me is the moment where the feminist politics shows. I did it, carried by history for a whole generation. it has to belong to others, although I hope that people will remember my role and it will be, will have my signature somewhere in invisible ink.
You are now the director of Institute of Humanities at the University of Utrecht, which gives you a totally different but very much rooted scope of doing and reshaping humanities in Holland and also in a European context. In a context when humanities and different programs in humanities are cut back because they were not needed according to the official propaganda. So what makes you humanities important and how do you define your role as a director of Institute of Humanities now in shaping new Europe?
I really am the champion of lost causes, aren't I? I mean, I started with feminism and now humanities, all the sort of losing causes in the world. Well, the program in gender that I built ended up being a program in the humanities. And as a philosopher, in some ways, I never really abandoned sort of the roots in the old humanities. Sometimes people find that my work lacks a sociological basis. Well, it does, and it doesn't come at all from the social sciences. So there is an attachment to the humanities that goes straight back. In the present situation in the Dutch university system, the battle to keep the humanities alive is extremely strong. We are all, as you know perfectly well, being cut back, etc. But the Dutch have decided that a strong tradition of the humanities will be continued, and Utrecht University is the university that will combine grand traditions with, radical innovation. I am the radical innovation pole, among others, in the faculty. And the idea of looking at what the notion of the human is in the humanities, which is the working title I've given to the new research program I'm writing. What is human about the humanities? What is the notion of the subject implicit in what we call the humanities? How does that notion of the subject manifest itself in the practice of how we are teaching the humanities? One of the issues, of course, that immediately has been put on my plate is the gender ratio. Faculties of the humanities across the EU are heavily feminized. In Utrecht, 70% of our students are women. If you look at the professorial body, 9% of the professors are women. Now, we have a problem. So there is an issue. Now, we haven't even started on the ethnicity issue. We are beginning to have amounts of students from other countries that are nationality migrant backgrounds, but there's not a single. I think Gloria Wecker is the only ethnic professor that we have in the whole university. So there's a number, the old gender issue is still there. But my aim, with the support of the Dean and the Vice Chancellor, is to radicalize the humanities by opening them up to the issues that are put on our plate by globalization. And what does it mean to defend Dutch literature, Dutch history in a world constructed like we do today? What is our message to the new wave of Indian and Chinese academics who are coming to visit our university and they're saying, we would like to send you our PhD students. What are you teaching? And then why would a PhD student from India or China want to study the humanities in Utrecht? What are we saying to the world? And I think it's that mandate that I find very interesting about the humanities, and the Center for the Humanities that we are trying to design would be a platform for the world where we'll be looking at the grand tradition, also traditions of radicalism. I mean, the Netherlands, from Erasmus of Rotterdam through to Theo van Gogh, have had public intellectuals which have been very provocative, and not to say downright offensive, and certainly disturbing the status quo. So a tradition of radical criticism, a tradition of, again, activism, however relying upon a university which is 460 years old, has several Nobel Prizes, and is one of the great universities in Europe, but trying to update it and make it socially relevant. In terms of the curriculum, this means bringing into the faculty through the Center for the Humanities the kind of theories which our very eminent distinguished colleagues refuse to teach or don't even want to recognize. Utrecht University still doesn't teach Foucault in any systematic manner. Post-structuralism is not taught across the EU. If you're trying to look at the philosophy department's reading list, they would stop somewhere around, if they're lucky, Heidegger, maybe that's already an advanced one. We don't touch post-war philosophy. Well, we will do a lot of critical social theory in the Center for the Humanities. We will discuss the crisis of the humanities and the solutions to the crisis. We will look at the intersection between the humanities and regimes of terror, be it fascism or communism and beyond, we will investigate the darker sides of the traditional humanity as well as the radical theories. So, of course, my gender training and my radical pedagogies will continue to be manifested, but given that the humanities wanting to survive, they have to open themselves up to everything which has been happening outside the university since the 70s. Universities' curricula in the humanities are antiquated, are out of date. The pedagogies in humanities faculties is feudal. And there's no point complaining that we are not getting the subsidies because, quite frankly, our performance as faculty of the humanities is pathetic. And if you look at our output, it is beneath any productivity level in any decent corporate structure. So there is a sense in which the humanities have to shape up. And they can't just rest on the past. And now faculty, Rembrandt and Descartes, yeah, we can leave off parasitically the past for a while, but we need to be relevant to the world today. So it's this mandate that I think I have now, and I find my years of working in gender perfect. And to give me an idea, I know exactly what kind of faculty I would design now. Just let me do it, and you'll get a state-of-the-art and humanities faculty with tradition, innovation, and with productivity rates that would make us very competitive in the labor market. And I think this is what Utrecht has given me the chance to do, and I hope I can rise to this new and rather formidable challenge.
You built up the best women studies center in Europe. Why did you invest so much energy and intellectual creativity into discipline and into an institution which is usually considered to be extremely marginalized and not really career enhancing activity?
Oh, they are so misguided, the people who say that. I think women's studies, gender studies is alongside other interdisciplinary areas, the laboratory through which we will redefine the humanities in the third millennium. There are enormous laboratories, workshops for new ideas. I am of the generation that started women's studies as part of a strategy that we defined then, the long march through the institutions, modeled on the left-wing ideas of cultural revolutions, going into the institutions to change them from within. So the main thing about women's studies was entering the institutions and in a rigorous manner transform the curriculum. The basis for it still remains empirically quite clear and firm. Women are underrepresented in every area of academic social life. If you open any history books until you started writing yours, women would be absent. Anyway, that the history of national literature, then the arts, cinema, theatre, women may be a footnote or play a subsidiary role. They may be the actresses and they may be the makeup artists. They are never center stage. So there was a sense of just making justice to the absence of women from the way in which science and scholarship is told in the humanities. The other big target, big aim was introduce the big novelty that was feminist knowledge, feminist consciousness, and feminist ideas. So there is a critical side and a creative side. And the difficulty was the creative part. I think the critical, even conservative professors could see that, in fact, we didn't do justice to the women writers, to the, to the specific problems of women. But coming in with alternative pedagogical methods, bringing in the personal as the source for the theoretical, that proved very controversial. So epistemology, methodology were really the great battle lines. And there, an immediate disadvantage that we had, still have, I think, is that when you're looking at the tools, the methodological tools, the basic concepts, they are all forged in the Anglo-American world. The English language dominates the state of scholarship in general. It's not very different in philosophy, but it is dramatically present in new emerging areas. I sometimes think that when we do gender theory, we are all thinking in translation. We're all thinking in a language that is not our own. This is due to the fact that in the European context, we don't have enough fundamental research, not enough knowledge about the history of women and the history of women's movements to generate methodological tools that would allow us to have feminist theories that reflect our own historical realities. We need a lot more work in the European context in order to produce the theories that we need. The moment I realized this, which was very early, I really took up the opportunity of subsidies from the European Commission to construct European networks.
Women's studies centers are located in the national system of higher education. They are measured in national measures. You are the founder of the Athena, the European Network of Women's Studies, which actually very much contributed to the institutionalization of women's studies all over in Europe. So how do you see the role of women's studies in this European context?
I think the European dimension is absolutely central to the work that we are doing if we acknowledge that as European feminists, European gender specialists, we have this issue of having to think in translation. Even the term gender, and it's one of my quarrels about which we have written extensively and you have written extensively, that gender doesn't translate easily across any of the European languages. And yet it is the dominant concept, so we have to come to terms with it. I think realizing a situation of deficit, which is not only sort of simply theoretical, it's due to a lack of grounding of feminist practice in our own national traditions. The problem in Europe is always the same, it's nationalism. It's always been the issue, it is the virus of the European system. Feminism has not really been able to have a lot of impact. I think Eastern Europe would be an interesting example to look at, and because of different national traditions that react to feminism in different and complex ways. We need to study the history of that interaction between European national identities and feminism in order to generate the tools that we need. The European network is the perfect arena for this. The work that people like yourself have done on historical memory, what do the women of today remember of their mothers and, more importantly, grandmothers' generation? What do they know about what it was like to be a Hungarian woman now in 1918, to be part of an empire and then to be part of another empire and then finally to become members of the EU? These are three dramatic historical locations. The region I come from in Italy, Friuli, and my grandmother stayed put. It is the eastern frontier. She stayed in the same place, and the frontier moved around her. And she ended up having four different nationalities by the time she died, a member of the EU. So stories like that are histories of immigration, history of nationalism, history of doing and undoing of empires, including the Nazi fascist empire, including the communist empire. Those stories really need to be studied. So I think the European Women's Studies is research-driven in the sense that we need the fundamental research on European human rights, civil rights, and women's rights in order to generate the theoretical tools and also the teaching material that we need to produce. Until we do that, we will be yabbering on, repeating theories which may be perfectly exciting and wonderful and right, but generated, grounded elsewhere. This grounding, locating of theories is important for women's studies because we think from lived experience. It is women's studies is a radical and empirical area. We think from lived experiences. The personal is the theoretical. So if our history is one of emerging from communism or fascism, that's a very different predicament from being Californians writing from that location or New York radical feminist writing. Now, three quarters of the teaching books that we have in gender studies are produced along the New York-London axis. And to produce teaching material, research material from the European condition remains an enormous issue. Polylinguism, the multiplicity of languages is an issue. The lack of available publishing houses is one. So the problems are quite enormous. It's a situation of semi-colonization that we are in. So the European dimension is built into my understanding of how to do women's gender studies, in a scientifically accurate manner as well as in a politically useful manner. We have to ground it. We have to stop repeating whatever is coming across the ocean. We can use it, but critically, analytically, and try to ground it in our own reality. We have to study our own backyard and not use an education to run away to something that looks terribly appealing and scientifically really exciting, only because the grass is always greener on another campus. Now, let's have a look at what's happening in our own backyard. So it's about politics of location at the end of the day.
How gender studies and women's studies can contribute to dismantling the fortress of Europe? Fortress of Europe, which this new concept of Europe, which is so prevailing nowadays.
Great question. The issue, the European dimension of a work is so important, as I said earlier, that it should play out into a renewed awareness of all the opportunities and challenges that come with the European Union. This is a very complicated issue, however. The interest and, in and excitement about the political potential of the European Union is diminishing greatly, not only because we have at present a political class, Sarkozy would be in France would be an example, that is not committed to Europe as a political project. There is a commitment to Europe as an economic, financial, even as a social and a military project. But the idea of a political space, which was the original idea of the founding fathers, including of the first commissioner, Spinelli, that is really not very fashionable these days. The idea of creating a social democratic space, the European Union, as an alternative social model that would not be the rampant, brutal neoliberalism of the USA, would not be state socialism either, but a mixed economy that would still have enough welfare provisions but be competitive on the market. Everything that you would think any decent human being living today would want. Well, that is proving very, very difficult. Tony Blair damaged it tremendously, and the right across Europe and across parts of Eastern Europe also is fighting it in the name of their own idea of reconstructed neo-nationalism. I think the enemy of the European Union is obviously nationalist assumptions and identities. I think that the feminist input into this particular political debate could be, and would be, if we could have it our way, to introduce some question marks about what we mean by cultural identity, by national identities, to insert a skeptical doubt about the validity, the divinity of these sacred notions of I am Hungarian, I am an Italian, I am Belgian. And thank God Belgium is falling apart, so people can see that even nations like that, you know, don't really have an eternal lifespan before them. Feminism is a radical critique of steady identities, starting from the notion that national identities are somewhat sacred and untouchable. If you look at the opposition to the European Union across the political spectrum in Europe today, it is always the right-wing sort of nationalists that fear that the European Union will steal their national identity from them. And at the other far extreme of the political spectrum, the far left, who is always fighting for, you know, cosmopolitan, universal brotherhood of men. So there are two opposites, but the nationalism on the part of the right is the enemy to everything. Introduce a question mark. Question again, what does it really mean to be a Hungarian? Is it one identity? Recently in the Netherlands, Princess Maxima, the crown princess, presenting a report about the state of the Netherlands, which, by the way, is doing extremely well at the moment, quoted a famous sort of sentence saying, there is no such a thing as a fixed and steady national identity. There was an uproar across the Netherlands. 75% of the Dutch declared themselves in vehement disagreement with our future queen, Crown Princess Maxima, because she had dared to suggest that something like a fully completed national identity may not exist. Now, this is the Netherlands today, a country that has a few issues, but it would be pretty representative, I think, of how the average Europeans would react if you say a European is somebody like me. It's an Italian grown up in Australia, educated in France, speaking four languages, moving to wherever the job takes her, meeting friends in Hungary that will be, you know, going off to the States very soon, and so on. We are, you know, in between. Culture is part of being Europeans. We've always been mixed. We've always been, you know, polylingual. What is it at the moment that makes us narrow down our notions of national identity to the smallest, most rigid, most uninteresting common denominator? European Union is the chance to open that up and to question the relationship between national identity and what a citizenship of a European Union could be like. So delinking the national identity from a sense of being citizen of a larger social space, the European Union. I think this is the lesson that feminism could take it, because we had to do similar operation in relation to gender identity and how we belong to the masculine and feminine section of society, negotiating those steps and transitions. We could be a model for how identities are renegotiated.
you are coming from an anti-fascist family. So what's your attitude, also as a philosopher, to the revival of fascism in Europe in its different and sometimes changing, but sometimes very much the similar forms?
Interesting one. My family is a typical Italian family. Half was fascist, the other half was anti-fascist, but I take my identification from the anti-fascist grandfather, who was a hero of the resistance. How we relate to fascism in the European context is so much a question of genealogies, and it is just staggering, even today, how long the shadow of fascism is in organizing the cultural memory of people. And we're getting students, perfectly democratic, open-minded students, whose knowledge of fascism is entirely determined by the kind of family background they have, and which is very often made of silence and omissions and of secret guilt. So I would locate fascism as a key element in the European understanding of what we should be doing with an education in the humanities. I think courses in on colonialism and fascism would have to be absolutely compulsory in a third millennium faculty of the humanities that want to do justice to, for instance, why we have a European Union. People may not even know that we have a European Union because we are responsible for fascism. It was the punishment that we had to undergo for having given the world two, in fact, world wars. So knowledge about it, awareness of it. Now, that would be the first step, because from there, a number of issues then emerge. I define fascism as something that a movement that proposes rigid and fixed identities, absolute sacralization of national identity. It is ethnocentric to a delirious degree, and the delirium is part of it. It is a delirium of hatred that just translates into intolerance of others, racism, genocide. It is absolutely a state of delirious intolerance of others. It has violence built into it, and it has another element that is very important for feminism. It has the absolute sacralization of masculine authority. It is authoritarian, it is masculine, and it is holy. Now, when we look at the films of Benito Mussolini or Adolf Hitler today, we may find them grotesque and have a good laughter. But if you imagine yourself, I'm thinking of the films of Leni Riefenstahl, for instance, if you imagine yourself being inside a crowd that was deliriously in love with that particular leader, I mean, in the case of Mussolini, it's almost comical because the man is so ridiculous. But this is a mass murderer and a criminal that sent millions to their own death while he was parading his cocky masculinity. So he is grotesque and ridiculous. He's also a criminal and a mass murderer. With Hitler, it's a little bit more difficult because he is pathetic, so it's a very different type of affectivity. But to sort of imagine being inside that crowd and think, now, would I have been able to keep my head cool? So the other element of fascism is that mass delirium, which people like Reich and Maciocchi, to mention two, have analyzed in terms of an eroticization of the public space. It's mass rallies where people just go delirious in their adoration of a strong leader. The idea that the strong leader is there to solve your problems, that the man of the heavens will fall and he will have the solution to everything. Just leave it to him. Just delegate your decision-making processes to a man, white, local, national, who knows better. I think that gesture is constitutive of fascism. And I see strong elements, I'm not the only one, of that type of delegation of your own autonomy or agency to one who knows better. I see that happening very strongly around us with mixing degrees. I'm not sure that we are in proto-fascist times, but a key question for discussion here would be the role of the media. The fascists were the first manipulators of popular cultures. They use radio, they use cinema, you singing brilliantly. Somebody like Berlusconi is a massive, major manipulator of the media. Is he proto-fascist? I'm not sure, but there is, I think, in contemporary populist politics, there is a fascist element of delegation of your you know, decision-making processes to a leader who is eroticized. He can be a cretin, usually it is a cretin, but it is, you know, he leave it to him, he can take care of things. Now, this is happening today to a very large extent, and I think teaching the history of the historical manifestation of fascism, showing those films, may be an antidote so that people can put two things together and say, okay, I keep my wits about myself. You know, I will still be the one to decide, and you can still enjoy, you know, the spectacle of masculine authoritarianism. But just don't lose your wits and don't go delirious about it. Keep thinking for yourself.
You wrote in your works extensively about the responsibility of intellectuals critiquing the fascism and the Nazism. And you very often mention the responsibility of the intellectuals not addressing the issue of discontinuity in critical leftist tradition. So how do you see this issue related to the emerge of fascism and proto-fascism in Europe today?
It's absolutely true that the extent to which the exodus of intellectuals during fascism and Nazism had an enormous impact, among others, on the structure of our universities and how we teach humanities and social sciences, and not only, but the fact that the best Jewish and left-wing communist minds had to run for their life or died in the camps simply shaped the way in which, since the post-war period, we've been teaching philosophy, social sciences, and the humanities in this continent. And this fact is never discussed. Admittedly, after the Second World War ended, another war began immediately. The Cold War, so-called, immediately split the world into two camps. And as the phenomenon of McCarthy in the United States proves, it was very difficult for intellectuals in the West to actually be critical, because you were immediately accused of being a sympathizer with the enemy. So I think that there really, for many, many years, I would say until 1989, Cold War scholarship had to be on the side of the West. You couldn't really afford to say, but you know, you know, we have a few skeletons in the closet, you know, we are responsible for what is happening out there. The Berlin Wall on the Eastern Front was called the anti-fascist barrier. I mean, there are very good reasons for that, but people don't remember that. They don't remember the role the fascism played in starting the Second World War. So lots of omissions and a lot of missing links here. And in terms of the way in which we teach the material, you know, the denazification of Europe, of European universities after the war, meant that we basically imported American social sciences. We imported American moral philosophy. We didn't reconnect to the roots of European critical theories, which had been destroyed by Nazism. The Nazis burned in their fires Sigmund Freud, Karl Marx, and Charles Darwin. They burned them as enemies of European civilizations. From there, they went on to burn people, because first you burn books, then you burn people. Simple. Now, it took us, well, I don't think actually, it took us forever to reconnect to Sigmund Freud, Karl Marx, and Darwin. When Louis Althusser starts teaching Marx in Paris in the 70s, he is bringing back Karl Marx. When Jacques Lacan is teaching psychoanalysis in Paris in the 70s, he's bringing back Sigmund Freud. And in both cases, they are explicit in saying, we're bringing them back because fascism killed them. And because the Americans are not interested in them, we don't have them because they're not part of American social sciences either. Now, talk about the humanities in Europe. It's a missing link. So I think the education system after 1989 needs to reorganize the curriculum in a way that goes beyond the Cold War omissions and silences. And this is a pretty massive one, because if people don't, again, read Adorno's analysis of the rise of fascism and how, you know, mass media contributed to the manipulation of millions of people, if they don't read Reich's analysis of how sexuality in the public sphere, the seduction of the strong leader works, well, then we are missing some fundamental analytical tools. And when populism is on the rise like it is in Europe today, then we are missing, again, navigational tools that would allow us to see populism as a regression, as a form of stupidity, as a form of violence, and as a denial of our own history. It's a tremendously ignorant sort of gesture to imagine that any you know, national identity in the European context is one forever equal to itself. It is only an ignorant nobody would make such a statement. Now, the point is, where are the intellectual voices that could correct that and introduce that complexities, and how we narrate the history of the Second World War and the role of fascism is absolutely crucial in this.
There is a tendency nowadays to equal fascism, Nazism with communism. What do you think about this?
It's a perfect example of the type of ignorance I was talking about. It is at times well meant, in the sense that both fascism and communism have blood in their hands, that millions of people died in the respective camps. So you can equate them in some abstract sort of moral balance. But as historical and political events, they are dramatically different. And to equate them is not to really help the debate or to do justice to anything. And certainly this is very, of course, common in Eastern Europe as an argument, but it is also now used in countries like Italy to justify. It's a flattening out of history, and then everything is the same, everybody is equally guilty, so end of stories. And the idea that, you know, that everybody is equally guilty is what I would challenge. I ran a quick survey in a class recently, asking, it was a class on women and war, and I asked the student, mostly women in the class, where they had positioned the Soviet Union in the, you know, general landscape of the, in the history of the Second World War. Well, all of them, being pure product of the post, of the amnesiac post-1989 world, all of them betrayed complete ignorance over the fact that the Soviet Union was our ally in the fight against Nazism. All of them said, well, of course, you know, Soviet Union was the enemy. And I said, just a moment, the Battle of Stalingrad? Never heard of it. All convinced that the war was won in Normandy, and all convinced the level of the ignorance, and because it's all been shaped by a kind of a post-war, post-Cold War equation that produces historical aberrations. Now, anybody who was a feminist in Western Europe, of the left as we all were in Western Europe, would have been brought up in the greatest admiration of the women of Eastern Europe who fought Nazism. Whether it is the Soviet woman or the Yugoslav partisan, you would stand up to them because you knew that you owed those women your freedom. Okay, this is the education I got. And you understood also that those poor men and women got a rough deal with Stalinism and beyond. It doesn't mean that you are blind to everything else that communism became, but that lack of awareness of the extent to which the Red Army fought for our freedom with all of their limitations, and those women fought for our freedom, fills me with despair. Because then you can only look at communists as not the enemy or the poor suckers who really got a rough deal from history and owe them nothing. And I feel that it is a double betrayal, really, that we don't recognize the historical debt, and that we don't recognize them, even don't give them a minimum of historical memory. It's quite a tragedy in the cultural memory of a classic, a typical feminist woman of Western Europe, former Western Europe today, the free, autonomous, independent, pride, Eastern communist woman has disappeared. She does not exist. She has been written over by this equation, fascism, communism. Communism is the losers of history. We put them on the garbage bin and we ignore them and forget them. And this is why I think that the work that you're doing with the grandmothers and resurrecting that memory is of the greatest importance. We are betraying them tremendously. So this is one of the many elements in terms of feminist history and in political history in general, the equation. Fascism or Nazism equal communism is just the preface to the most crass and ignorant form of populism.
So you're a feminist philosopher. My question would be, just very briefly, how you see the main contributions of feminism to the big discipline of philosophy itself?
Well, my working definition of feminism is, it's one of the few social movements that combines a strong commitment to changes in the social transformation with in-depth changes of the self. So there is as much emphasis on social constructivism, changing how the gender system influences the construction of identity, social structures, the labor market, and representation issues. as much emphasis on that as on what is the notion of the subject that allows us to have a gender system that functions through the binary of the masculine and the feminine. So I would put the area of both, let's say, social philosophy, social justice, social theory, and the area of subjectivity and all the issues connected to subjectivities, ethics and politics, as the areas where the big impact of feminism has been. And if you look at the scholarship, it falls really into two types, no matter what their theoretical underpinnings are, two types of scholarships, critical and creative. There's critical scholarship that looks at how the social construction of gender occurs, how the gender system influences the wage disparity between men and women, how assumptions about masculinity prevent women from being popes and archbishops in the Catholic religion, from being generals in the army, and until recently from being university professors. So how ideas and assumptions, let's say ideological apparatus, actually influence social reality. So that's more the critical side. In the case of philosophy, how come that the contribution of women to philosophy is always negated? That there is simply not a great woman philosopher until Queen Christina of Sweden comes in, because she is a good friend of good old René Descartes. I mean, it is just such an injustice. So the absence of attention to the social, physical presence of women in philosophy is how that methodology would manifest itself. More interesting is the creative scholarship, which says, okay, we have this deficit, we have the absence of recognition of what women have produced as philosophical wisdom and philosophical knowledge, although Socrates does say that everything that he knows about philosophy was taught by a woman, Diotima, but I mean, it was a nice recognition of the female origins of wisdom, but that was since forgotten. So the creative approach says, okay, we have all of that, but let's not insist too much on the negative. Let's see what alternatives we can offer. And I think feminist philosophy has been very creative in producing alternatives, drawing in the first generations from the tradition of women's writing, because as we know, unfortunately, we as a gender have not been educated for very long. Universities have been segregated for upper-class people and men until really the 20th century, the second half of the 20th century. So as a gender, women historically have been kept ignorant. Even today, 65% of the world illiterate are women, little girls and young women. We're just not getting the education. So it's very difficult to become a philosopher if you're not being educated at all. Learning to read and write would be a good beginning. We also know that women take care of children, of family, of aging relatives, so that there is a sense in which completing an education is a big issue for a woman. We have a lot of women who return to higher education after having taken care. So it's the idea of women's education precedes the question of what women can do to philosophy. So drawing from the vast body of under-recognized women's literature or women's ways of knowing, feminist philosophy has, over the last 20 years, produced alternative forms of understanding what counts as knowledge, what counts as relationships to the other. I'm thinking of the ethics of care as an area where feminism has made a big impact, mm-hmm. through Carol Gilligan and others, that actually taking care of the other is a form of knowledge of the other. You can't take care of either children or relatives or aging parents without a mode of relation and understanding. It takes understanding, it takes interpreting the other in order to be able to take care. So how come ethical theories, you know, neglect the fact that the great ethical agents in the world have been women? We're the caretakers, we're the ones who do the caring, but we somewhat don't do the theorizing. So theorizing from the lived experience of women. Another example would be politics. We've always defined politics as the big, you know, mass movement, or either mass movement and revolution or parliamentary procedures. What about a vision of the political that would actually take in the politics of everyday life, the little microscopic gestures of inclusion and exclusion, of authority and marginalization, which shape our social existence? And so a difference between politics as usual and the political as a process by which we can zoom in on microscopic relations of power. That's another, I think, important contribution of feminist philosophy, in which I think the key terms would be being grounded, being situated, starting from the lived experience of a group that has been socially marginalized and symbolically absent.
Where do you see the greatest lacks that still exist in feminist philosophizing? Where do you see that we still need more work?
Well, we need more work across the spectrum. So the more the better. I hope millions of younger men and women go into feminist philosophy, because we need more help. More specifically, I think that the emphasis in terms of the scholarship over the last 20 years has been in certain areas, as I said, of philosophy, ethics, politics, social philosophy. We have been much less active in other areas which have proved or are proving extremely important, one of them being science and technology studies. Epistemology in feminist theory has always been linked to the lived experience and theorizing the knowledge of the oppressed. So we've done that very well in a Foucauldian, a proto-Foucauldian sense of the term. Addressing the development of contemporary science and technology and engineering is something that we have done much less. Partially because in Western Europe, contrary to Eastern Europe, women in engineering is not a big area. And the women engineers that we have that are growing in numbers are not very sympathetic to feminism. They are women who are functioning well in a man's world, have a maths education, are not interested in social sciences. So for a number of reasons, are really distancing themselves from feminism. I think we need to address more directly the disciplinary divisions. How come that what we have to say makes sense to people in history and makes no sense to people in engineering, in astrophysics, and in biogenetics? I think that this, the areas of technology studies is at the moment growing very, very fast, and there are interesting new combinations being made since Donna Haraway and her school of modern science studies. So this is definitely one area that we need to do a lot more on, and I expect generations and contemporary younger women to go towards. Another area that historically has been part of feminism but hasn't really theoretically been up to scratch is environmental issues. And because the future is green or there is no future, I think environmental questions need to be addressed again from the angle of women. We have a long tradition of ecofeminism, but it has been rather of the holistic and sort of what we would call essentialistic kind, that the women relate to nature because we're all excluded from culture, and it takes some pretty, you know, comical forms, women hugging trees, which is really cute but doesn't go very far. So looking at what environmentalism could do, could connect to the status of women in the context of globalization, when women are still the agricultural workers throughout the world and are really getting the rotten end of the globalization stick, and they're really not getting a fair deal, that would be another area. Last but not least, the whole question of the post-secular. What is happening around issues of religion or spirituality in a world where religions are connected to wars, to civilizational wars? A great deal of the problems of today are due to the limitations of what was the classical methodology of social constructivism. And there's a return of creationism, there are a return of an appeal to a higher authority, divine authority. God is not dead at all. So I think addressing the post-secular from the angle of women's complicated relationship to religion is another one. But be assured, the third feminist wave of younger women is at work. They're very busy, they are very active, they are doing very well. So I'm very, very optimistic that all of these questions will receive a lot of attention, and the self-appointed third feminist wave will make its entry into philosophy as it is in other areas of contemporary culture.
So I would like to know about your figuration, nomadic subjects, and the respective theory that you have formulated in your book, Nomadic Subjects. Could you please expand on that on that concept? Because for an ordinary person to hear nomad is usually more like a pejorative, a negative concept, referring to someone who who moves constantly without having any roots. So I was wondering how you create a whole theory on that and how you can turn it into something more constructive.
Well, I did a little bit on purpose. I'm perfectly aware of what, you know, nomads and nomadic people represent in European culture and also in European history. The Roma or nomadic people are the other category of individuals that fascism exterminated and sent to the camps. So to choose that particular figuration is a way of positioning my philosophical work in a certain tradition of criticism of an ethnocentric idea of Europe. A figuration is not just a metaphor, it's a cartography, it's a way of mapping. And a map is also made of historical knowledge. You're drawing out a sort of a location. And I wanted to do that with nomadism in relation to my awareness, my consciousness of what it means to be a European. The precedent for it is Friedrich Nietzsche, of course. His idea of Europe as the place that should be able to recognize its instability, its fluidity, and criticize a certain idea of Europe as a superego sort of entity. So for me, the first function of nomadism is to criticize an idea of European philosophy connected to an idea of European culture as fixed, steady, transhistorically dominant, always in charge of the course of its own history. And that really proto-fascist, logocentric, phallocentric idea of what it means to be a subject of knowledge, a subject of history, a subject of the European civilization. So it's deliberately done as a critical analytical tool to try to destabilize that idea. One concrete example in how it functions in the history of philosophy is even today, if you're trying to teach inside philosophy the contribution of Islam to Western philosophy, you will be met with the greatest, you know, degree of shock and horror. To suggest that it was through the Islamic world that the entire legacy of Greek antiquity made it into European civilization is something that most Europeans don't want to hear, not in university departments, certainly not in the streets of Europe today, where Islam is synonymous with backwardness, ignorance, and terror. So the idea of nomadism, the European culture and civilization, if we want to use the term, and certainly European philosophy, are made of multiple influxes from Arab culture, from various brands of Judaism, from waves of migrations, from the Vikings through the Huns and the multiple hordes coming from the East, through our own migratory patterns, through colonialism that allowed us to conquer and loot the wealth of the world, that what we call European culture is a constant set of nomadic influences. And to throw that against this monolithic idea of the subject, man as the measure of all things, European man, white man's burden, not the eternal culture of this white bastion of rationality and objectivity that is Western man. That is such rubbish, and that rubbish has to stop. It's historically inaccurate, it is politically bankrupt, and it is, in terms of the history of philosophy, a falsification of how we came to be the culture that we are today. So that's the first level.
So what does nomadism have to offer us as a more creative model of subjectivity?
Nomadism is practicing a very happy form of interdisciplinarity in the sense that it starts as a discourse, I mean, my practice, about philosophy and how philosophy is practiced, but it also strikes an alliance very quickly with gender studies, with anti-racism, with cultural studies, and to look at what form of interdisciplinary thinking do we need in order to make sense of the world today. A pure history of philosophy, a pure history of any discipline, is not going to be very useful for anybody who wants to make sense of the third millennium, either you like complexities or you can't survive as a thinker, as a professional in the third millennium. Things are complex. They're complex because we are an old and sophisticated culture. As Salman Rushdie put it, why should we simplify that which history has made complex? So let's respect the complexities. So interdisciplinarity, which means working a lot harder, not being happy to just stay within a sterile history of a discipline, but look around, open it up, be interested in the world in which these ideas are circulating. In relation to this, what nomadic philosophy offers, at least in my brand, which incorporates feminism and anti-racism and human rights, is the idea of mobility instead of fixed identity. That identity is a process, not a given. That if you're talking about the subject, you're looking at an entity which is complex, not transparent. That we can no longer today, if ever, be satisfied with the Cartesian promise of transparency. I think, therefore I am. Mm-hmm. That is unimaginable for the scientists of today, for the citizens of today. This equation of subjectivity with consciousness, of consciousness with rationality, of rationality with objectivity, is a narrowing down of that which our intelligence, our levels of knowledge require of us today. So complexity, multi-layeredness instead of unity, and emphasis on processes, which means relations, that we are looking at multiple ways of relating to the social environment that sociology has always agreed. We relate to social codes. Fine, so far, so good. Mm. We need to go much further than that. We relate to each other in interpersonal relations in manners that are politically and ethically productive and complicated. Mm. We relate to our environment, to the oxygen that we consume, to the water that we are wasting, to the consumption of natural resources. We relate to that in very many contradictory ways. So we need to think in terms of networks of relations that make the nomadic subject capable of relating to his or her territory. The nomad is, you know, very territorial. It's somebody that goes through space. And I like the territorial metaphor because it is very situated. It allows you to locate your practice. I'm a European. I am responsible for this particular territory. But a territory is also a psychic mapping. And a psychic mapping is a slice of history. If you're looking at a church, you have to know, oh, this, you know, so-and-so. It's part of a history. You can't read a map if you don't know what the landmarks are. So it takes historical awareness to move across space. So the nomadic subject is historically infused, is somebody with a strong historical memory, oral as well as written, as somebody that refuses to forget. And I think forgetting to forget is a good definition for cultural memory in Europe. The nomads forgets to forget the bad aspects of European culture as well as the glorious aspect of European culture. It keeps in mind a broader view in order not to narrow down the sort of level of consciousness. As a sort of a program, as a normative model, ideally, the nomadic subject would be capable of combining this multi-layeredness, multiplicity, complexity, with accountability, ethical agency, a sense of responsibility. There is an idea that if you move between places, you're irresponsible and you don't care for any of them. I don't know where that idea originates from, but anybody who studies even migrant sociology, let alone intellectual history, will know that people are capable of multiple forms of belonging. That in the same way that we speak many languages, we can be attached to, responsible for, accountable to, linked to multiple communities. And that doesn't mean that you are nowhere or that you are a suspect alien. It just means that you are a complex person that comes from different cultures and speaks different languages. European history has always been like that. Read Hannah Arendt on the origins of totalitarianism, where she's talking about the role of Judaism in inventing Europe, because the Rothschild brothers spread across Europe and invented modern banking because they couldn't own anything else, or they owned money. It's the only thing that they could own, okay? The birth of modern capitalism, but it is also in some way a dispersion or a diaspora that creates Europe, revalorizing mobility, diasporic subjects as decent citizens, and through that attacking this absolutely epidermic intolerance towards nomads, towards gypsies, towards alien others, towards foreigners who speak with a funny accent, towards people who are not of this place. And I hope that in my own life, in my own work, I can provide some sort of counter-argument. I am of many places. I have two passports. I am today a privileged citizen of, you know, the academic classes. I come from migration and working class. I, in everything I've done, I've kept clearly in mind a mission to really prove that you can have multiple identities, many passports, and be a decent citizen, because citizenship is not a birthright or a God-given. Citizenship is a process and a project by which you belong, you contribute, and you do your best, even though, guess what, you may not be of this place.
You very often talk about the melancholic state of mind of today. I'm wondering if the situation is so bad as you see it. Are you pessimistic? And how can we, is there a way out? What is the way out?
I'm not pessimistic at all. I'm pathologically optimistic as a general rule. But I do consider melancholia a sort of dominant ideology in the world today, and it is an ideology. It is not just a psychological state. Let me explain what I mean. One example could be the discourse about the end of all possible ideologies. You know, if communism has failed, and fascism, God forbid, there is only one hope for us: capitalism. Capitalism is the inevitable logic of history. I don't, you know, I may agree or not agree with this, and I obviously don't, but my point is this idea that there is one logic to history. This is it. What you see is what you get. Everything else is impossible, dangerous, it has failed. That alone is a recipe for, you know, collective depression. To think that this is it, this is, and consequently, the one logic of history, you know, you better make the most of it, because you're not going to be able to change it, because it is the inevitable course of human history. Mm-hmm. Since 1989, we've had a neo-evolutionary discourse proclaiming the inevitability of advanced capitalism as the path to human evolution. And that is, has caused more unrest and more raw inequalities in the distribution of wealth than we have seen since the 30s. So there's a sense in which melancholia is a product of this narrowing down of the historical horizon that is particularly painful, it seems to me, for the youth of today, because if you feel that there is nothing you can do that can change the course of history, well, then why bother? And when people complain that the youth of today is not, you know, politically active, that you have no, sorry to put you in the category, that you have no visions or ideas, well, quite frankly, why should you bother considering the environment that we are living in? I grew up in a world where change was on the agenda. And for the baby boomers of the 70s, reconstructing the future was the agenda. And the idea that social change is an act of love for the future, that if you want to improve the status quo, you're actually, you know, expressing your faith in the future. The future is going to be better. We can do, you know, better than this. Well, the ideology of today says that this is it, so why bother? So there's melancholia as an ideology is a way of preventing any visionary, imaginative energy to emerge from our rank and file, and it has produced sociologically waves of depression. We are a chronically depressed culture across the Western world, and you see this in the consumption of antidepressant drugs, Prozac, of course, we are Prozac nation, and also in forms of serious depression, including the rise on youth suicide. So melancholia is a dominant ideology, worries me, and I think that we need to address this. The other area where melancholia occurs is out of the previous revolutionaries. My generation of the baby boomers growing up with the winds of change Now, reaching middle age and taking stock of the situation, a lot of the members of my generation have decided that change is too complicated, the political transformation are too painful. Why don't we just carry on building good careers and getting on with it? And the number of former left-wing activists or citizens or intellectuals that have gone very, very right-wing or are, in a sense, working with or allying themselves to right-wing politicians. Just think of the situation in France with Sarkozy and Bernard Kouchner, Jacques Lang, to mention two lefties gone very right-wing. But before that, and a whole generation of intellectuals, Philippe Solers being one, who really repudiated the radical youth and went right-wing. Now, it's a little bit easy to repudiate radical youth after you have had it and you have profited from it. I find this a gesture of tremendous unfairness and intellectual dishonesty. But apart from this, this intellectual class has also marketed a sort of melancholy gloom, saying, we tried, you know, it failed, so now you just stay put. So there is also the melancholia of the failed sort of revolutionary. Mm-hmm. My answer to this is to take the question of melancholia very seriously and connect it to what I think a genuine issue in this is. I am very critical of the ideology of neoliberal destruction of the future, this idea that there is only one course to history that is rubbish scientifically and not helpful politically. But the theoretical point or the philosophical point is does not lie there. It lies on the idea that change is dangerous, change is painful. I think that that is the underlying concept that interests me in this. Because in my own practice, as somebody who has not given up the process of change, works with it through the institutional, continues to keep the radical fires burning because otherwise I can't stay alive myself, I do recognize that there is a problem with pain. There is a problem with the pain connected to wanting to change. For one thing, for your generation in the world of today, it makes you very unpopular. When everybody else is conforming, there you are fanatically still thinking we should be doing something about whatever issue is bothering you, and I hope that the status of women is one of them. So it makes you unpopular immediately. You have to swim against the stream, and that is already very tiring. It means it's complicated in terms of the stuff that you write. It's complicated in terms of a career path. Will there be jobs in human rights, women rights, gay rights by the time you finish your wonderful dissertation? There is an uncertainty that is connected to this. So already keeping up that idea of wanting to involves an immediate type of discomfort. It may be painful or not, but it doesn't make your life easy. More deeply still, changing the structures of subjectivity in a way that allows us to address the issues of masculinism, ethnocentrism, the long shadow of fascism, forms of populist proto-fascism today. Mm-hmm. All of that requires shifts in the structures of the self. And those they require us to ask of other people that they take on projects that will make them uncomfortable. We are asking them to suffer. Address the issue of European nationalism. Recognize your own intolerance towards, you know, the Roma next door or the gays in the streets. Just acknowledge that you are part of the problem. Means saying to people, acknowledge something that is painful, difficult, uncomfortable. In the women's movement, we had to do this time and time again. We started by not wanting to recognize ourselves in classical femininity. So that's a first break. Here are the women, here's classical femininity. Feminists, I call us the post-woman women. We come after classical femininity. So one break. Then the women talking about sexual preferences, gay women, lesbians, straight women, hetero, recognizing that these are powerful differences. So, okay, goodbye to the idea of one steady sexual identity. You know, you can actually love all kind of people. And do you fall in love with a human being or do you fall in love with a gender? You know, have the courage of addressing the complexities and recognize that actually it's an individual that does it, and whatever they happen to be is a little bit secondary. So another break from the idea that there is one steady, secure sexual identity that's going to protect you from temptations. Now, I can resist anything except temptations, so I'm a very good example of somebody that, that cannot fail. Then comes our Jewish, our black, our foreign sisters coming to say, you know, where are we in your way of thinking? When you say European feminism, am I a black woman, I'm a Muslim worker, am I part of your picture, or do I exist? So the recognition that actually, as European feminists, we may be kind of oppressed by a masculinist system, but as Europeans, we are oppressing large numbers of ethnic groups in our own society. So recognizing our own involvement in forms of racism. In other words, feminism has been very focused on how you achieve change by addressing internal obstacles, addressing things, issues that are involved in your way of thinking, and say goodbye to them, just because we're better off without racism, we're better off without heterosexism, we're better off being free in what we do. I think consciousness raising, which is the name that we give to this process, is the strength of feminism. I think what we are trying to offer then to the person next door, to your neighbor, is exactly the same. We're trying to say to them, you know, you're part of the problem. Now, you need to change this, because there's no point saying, oh, you know, people are racist. People are racist because we all are, and you are part of the problem. So you must become part of the solution, because if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. And I think we are asking people to undergo the pain of separation from identities that are familiar to them. Mm-hmm. Nationalism, racism, masculinism are familiar. It's European culture. We're asking them to say, cut, grow up, become a citizen of the third millennium, say goodbye to all that. It's going to be painful for a while, but what you gain in the process is going to be absolutely unmatchable and unmatched. You will profit tremendously. You will grow out of some of the worst aspects of European culture. So there is a process of pain involved with change that I think, you know, we can, as feminists, propose to the normal citizen, resting assured, using feminism as the historical precedent, that not only will it come good in the end, but through the pain, we will sail into the unknown, and through the unknown, we will actually be able to create the new. So take the pain. It is not only suffering. It's the pain of disidentification from identities that we don't need anymore. We don't need to be nationalist, we don't need to be racist, we don't need to be idiotic populist. Let's be third millennium Europeans. Let's grow up.